Good morning. I'm Diego Nunez from Mass General Brigham in Boston, and on behalf of the International Outreach Committee of the American Roentgen Ray Society, I would like to welcome you to this year's Global Exchange Session, featuring collaboration with the Spanish Society of Medical Radiology, SERAM. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to our moderator, Carlos Torres, who is Professor of Radiology at University of Ottawa. And they have put together really an interesting program where there'll be three speakers representing the American Roentgen Ray Society and three speakers from SERAM. And without further ado, they have this great topic on current imaging of brain tumors from child to adult. Carlos, take it away.
Thank you very much, Diego, for that kind introduction. So let's get the session started. I would like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Raymond Huang, who is a neuroradiologist. He's an associate professor at Harvard Medical School, and he works at Brigham Women's Hospital. And he's going to talk on imaging diagnosis of CNS tumors in the context of the new 2021 WHO classification. Welcome, Raymond.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. And I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to give this session. And it's great to be in person to give the talk. So these are my disclosures. None are relevant to this talk. So today, I would like to discuss some of the imaging science and the use of advanced imaging technology to help us diagnose CNS tumors, focusing on some of the new changes to the WHO criteria. And also go over some of the pitfalls and challenges. So I want to start with a case. This is a 58-year-old lady who came to us with a very vague symptom, vertigo, very common. We get MRI, and in this case, we see a non-enhancing small lesion in the corpus callosum. Okay, and the diagnosis then, well, we don't know what this is. Probably not related to the symptom, but this is probably some kind of, it could be, you know, tumor, glioma, or demyelinating. It's very nonspecific, just like many things. But it does cross corpus callosum, and this is an older patient. So recommendation was follow up in 3 months to see how he behaved without any, you know, like invasive procedure now. In 3 months, the lesion looked about the same size or appearance and no enhancement. So identical picture nearly, okay? So the recommendation then, you know, similar, we cannot exclude glioma that can grow slower, probably a low-grade glioma since it hasn't changed, or, you know, some kind of demyelinating process that, you know, hasn't changed. So recommendation then was maybe we need a longer-term follow-up, 1 year, so that sounds reasonable. So this is at 6 months before patient, you know, actually get to the scheduled imaging presenting with symptom. So now we're looking at a multifocal necrotic appearing enhancing mass crossing corpus callosum. So this is what we typically are used to, the classic appearance of glioblastoma, okay? So my question to the audience, you know, just for thought now, what would you do differently at the early, you know, initial presentation or at the 3 month time point, okay? And whatever we do, would that make a difference to patient's outcome? All right. Another case similar, we have a also older patient, non-enhancing tumor, had a biopsy showing astrocytoma grade 2. It's great for the patient, you know, I mean that is not glioblastoma given though this is a primary, likely brain tumor, primary brain tumor at this age. But a month later, a patient developed an enhancing nodule, and that was, you know, resected and turned out also to be glioblastoma. Okay. So with these two cases, I want to, you know, go over some of the evolution of the WHO criteria over the past few decades. And starting with 2007, and believe it or not, some of the 2007 concepts are still, we see those in the new radiology textbook. So I want to make sure that we see how these have been evolved to the new criteria. In WHO 2007, it was primarily a histological diagnosis for diffuse gliomas. For adults, and starting from grade 2 to grade 4 with increasing aggressiveness with histological features of, you know, increasingly with necrosis, proliferation of vessels, And on imaging, we have correlate. The lower grade tumors tend to be non-enhancing, non-necrosis. On the advanced imaging, it doesn't have elevated blood volume or high, it doesn't have any low diffusivity or hypercellularity. And on spectroscopy, tend to be low choline relative to NAA. And whereas the high grade tumor are the opposite, we see more necrosis, more nodular enhancement, and with these imaging, advanced imaging feature pointing to higher grade tumors. So that has been the framework for a long time. And coming in 2016, there has been introduction of the use of molecular markers to divide these tumors. And the reason for that is these molecular based division is a lot more accurate in reflecting patients' prognosis. So for example, an IDH mutant glioblastoma, they do a lot better than the IDH wild type glioblastoma. And therefore, IDH has been the key molecular marker for the diagnosis of brain tumor. And but despite that, our framework for imaging diagnosis, this is histological diagnosis plus a few markers, IDH and this one, 1P19Q correlation, allow us to divide oligodendrogranuloma glioma versus the astrocytoma IDH mutant. And it removes some of the ambiguity for, in the past we called these, some of these mixed tumors by histology, now we are able to divide them by molecular status. So this is an early framework to integrate molecular status to histological diagnosis. And in 2021, last year, there are a few more changes which are quite striking. One is that the glioblastoma has been removed from the IDH mutant type tumors, which means we cannot really call secondary glioblastoma anymore. Right? That's one major change. So that will really make a distinct population for these younger patient tumor that are coming from younger patients versus the older patients who are getting these much more aggressive IDH wild type tumors. Not only that, a new addition is that there are a few molecular markers that can be used to diagnose glioblastoma, and that is independent of histological grading. Right? So even if patient doesn't have any necrosis or microvascular proliferation, which was required to diagnose glioblastoma, that right now with the molecular mutation with these mutations, you can diagnose glioblastoma. And that can cause a lot of problem for radiologists for now. Like, why do we see a non-enhancing tumor? It can be a glioblastoma, but we cannot be confident in calling that at that stage. And that is exactly the reason we are seeing these tumors that are diagnosed as glioblastoma early on when we do these biopsies now. But for management, it's actually a lot better for a patient to know that this is going to be a bad tumor. It's going to turn into something necrotic and rapidly growing very fast. So you have to be more aggressive in treating these tumors. And also get these patients to proper treatment, but also in clinical trial selection to make sure that we don't treat, getting patients to be enrolled in low-grade tumor trials, because they're going to behave like glioblastoma. And some of the new advanced imaging technology allow us to be a little bit better than what we can see morphologically. So the IDH1-2 mutation is, I just want to give a very quick review in the Krebs cycle of the cell metabolism. The IDH wild-type proteins that catalyze the conversion of isocitrate to alpha-ketoglutarate. And in the mutant version of that, it shuts down this conversion. In exchange, they overexpress 2-hydroxyglutarate or 2-HG. And this compound can be detected by MR spectroscopy. And it's with this, the method is basically changing the TE to 97 in the 3T machine. And you can see this 2.25 parts per million peak distinctly away. It's very small, but using quantitative measurements, we can isolate this peak quite nicely. just give you an example. Again, this is a 64 similar non-enhancing tumor presenting with vague symptom. And of course, this can be either low or high grade. We can tell IDH or not. It's this sort of infiltrative appearing, pretty typical for glioma. But with spectroscopy, it was the lesion show a small 2HG peak. So it turned out to be a grade 2, the astrocytoma. And we've been asked, why does it matter since the patient is going to get surgery anyway, going to get the IDH diagnosis by molecular methods? Why do we bother to know ahead of time? Well, it turns out the non-enhancing tumors, if it's of a IDH variant, if you can resect the entire tumor, patients do have a lot better prognosis. Whereas the IDH wild type, it's not clear, meaning you know it doesn't probably doesn't matter what you do. The tumor probably already spread far beyond what we can see. So that is ongoing, you know, work to improve the spectroscopy and see how we can help clinically. The next few minutes, I'm going to show some of the specific imaging signs that allow us to diagnose some of these tumors, especially the oligodendroglioma. If we see a cortical lesion that's expansile and has some calcification, it has very specific, very high specificity for oligodendroglioma, and unfortunately, it's not very sensitive. Only about half the patient or fewer will have these imaging sign, and they tend to be more commonly in the frontal lobe, and they can show some elevated blood volume. And the edema tend to be mild, you know, in the lower grade stage. Occasionally, they can hemorrhage. So let's look at this case. A 42-year-old male with a cortical lesion in the sort of hand area of the precentral gyrus. Okay, it's mildly expansile, non-enhancing. And you can see on the susceptibility imaging a bit of a dark signal. So that turned out to be calcification. And we can be very confident, even though you know surgeons were probably not happy to be touching this area, causing major deficit in the in the left hand. That we know that this is not going to be a glioblastoma. This is going to be a nice behaving, and the life expectancy for this likely is going to be over 10 years. Okay. Look at, in contrast to this case, well, you know, there's this very heterogeneous, very large, a lot of edema. Okay. And, you know, so this, you know, an older patient can easily be a high grade, you know, a glioblastoma. But on the CT, you can see coarse calcifications. Okay, so this is a grade 3 oligodendroglioma with you know, with component that's already been transformed but still kept the calcification that tells us that it used to be probably a nice behaving grade 2 tumor and it has time to evolve to this large. Another imaging sign I want to point out, you know, I think some of you may know and heard of it, but this is an important sign that has been reported during the last, you know, 2-3 years and validated in large data sets. This is called a T2 mismatch sign. And this is a very specific sign, nearly 100%, for this particular, you know, genotype, meaning an IDH mutant tumor. It's a non-co-deleted tumor, meaning it's an astrocytoma. And the sign basically says it's if you have a mass that is well circumscribed on the T2 weighted images, and on the flare image, the central part of that become dark with a very bright rim. Again, you know, no edema, no enhancement, it's a very nice, well-circumscribed mass. With the sign, then 99% over, you're gonna be right that this is this particular genotype. Unfortunately, again, just like similar to the calcification sign on the oligos, it's only about half, 50% sensitivity. So if you see it, it's great. It helps you diagnose it with high confidence. But if you don't see it, it doesn't mean that it's not this type of tumor. This is just one example of that. You know, non-enhancing tumor, bright on the T2, dark on the flare with a bright rim. This is consistent with the astrocytoma, not the co-related tumor. This is a more challenging case now, not only, again, young patient, but not only one lesion, but three lesions. in the brain, it was came to us as a rule out demyelinating disease in young patient, multiple, you know, white matter lesion. It does involve, you know, the cortex and white matter. It does have some trace of T2 mismatch sign, meaning it's bright on T2, some dark component, but it doesn't really fit perfectly, meaning the T2 is not homogeneously, you know, bright on T2. There's some dark areas. Okay. Well, to try to figure out what this could be with this spectroscopy, and it shows a very distinct 2HG peak. So this is consistent with a IDH mutant tumor, and the diagnosis, it turned out to be grade 3 astrocytoma. Not only this one, they also resected this guy and the third tumor, and all of them have the same histology and molecular status. So as you can see, some of these, you know, tumor, they can start with these nice signs and evolve and slightly looking different. But if you look carefully, you can actually see trace of those signs. And if you put other data together, you can actually make quite confident diagnosis. This is not demyelinating disease. Okay. In the last few, you know, minutes, I want to, we spend most of our time focusing on the adult type diffuse glioma. And Dr. Ho is going to go through the pediatric tumors. But I want to point out the WHO do have these pediatric type tumors as molecularly defined as separate category because they have very different behavior clinically from the other type of diffuse gliomas, and they tend to be occurring in young kids. But I want to point out one case here. This is an older gentleman who present to us with a hemorrhagic mass. As you can see on the SWI image, there are dark areas. It's enhancing. It's primarily intraventricular with some edema, right? So looking at this, well, in hemorrhagic mass in adult, probably a high-grade glioma, metastasis. You know, you can probably entertain vascular lesions like cavernoma, except that there's no like T1 shortening. This turned out to be one of these pediatric type diffuse low-grade glioma of the MAPK pathway, which has the BRAF and FGFR. And these tumors tend to be hemorrhagic. I want to show this case just because it becomes much more complex now with molecularly defined status. And these pediatric type tumors do occur in adults, like in this case, in the 60-year-old man. Okay, so. Of course, these are rare, but you know, we're going to see more of these tumors that's going to be behaving very differently from glioblastoma or mets and other high-grade tumors in adults. And lastly, I want to close with this case. This is a 25-year-old male who came to a neurosurgical clinic. This is a pre-op imaging showing a wall-circumscribed temporal parietal mass. Okay. And it's high, it's very young, you know, so we're expecting some probably likely low grade given that it's very well circumscribed, young patient. The DWI is very high, the ADC is sort of intermediate to low, but it's not like acute infarct low. And patient present with, you know, just one time seizure, otherwise healthy, okay, and non-enhancing. So at the time we're thinking, well, this could be a glioma, but it doesn't follow the expectation of, you know, for low grade to have ADC, you know, looking like intermediate to low value. So this could be something else. So we follow it. Instead of recommend, you know, we stop the surgeon and say, you should wait. And 3 weeks later, the flare abnormality pretty much resolved. The DWI also resolved. And we're seeing some of these cortical enhancements. So this is subacute infarct. So I want to just want to make sure that you keep the mimickers in mind when we make the, you know, try to diagnose these brain tumor. So in summary, WHO 2021, we have the introduction of extension of the 2016 criteria with the molecular status, but much more refined now, and including some of the molecular definition of glioblastoma. And that has, you know, going to be much more challenging for us to figure out these high versus low grade. And we have advanced imaging tools and some of the imaging signs that can help us to figure out these molecular subtypes. And just keep in mind of the tumor mimickers, because that's going to be our most added value as radiologists to tell them this is probably not tumor, something else. Okay, thank you for your attention.